Welcome to another virtual Putney Music, and especially to our guest, Stephen Walsh, the eminent writer, music critic, and academic, whom I've had the pleasure of knowing for over 60 years. We go back to 1960, when Stephen as a tenor won a choral scholarship to Gonville and Caius College Cambridge, where I was organ scholar. Stephen's year, I may say, was exceptional. Three out of the four choral exhibitioners, as they were called, became university professors. Richard Frewer, professor of architecture at Bath University, Alec, now Lord Browers, who was to become vice chancellor of Cambridge University, is a brilliant electronic engineer whose research into nanotechnology has been recognized worldwide. And talking of international reputations, the same very much applies to you, Stephen. In addition to your work as a lecturer and later emeritus professor of music at Cardiff University, and as music critic for several national newspapers, you've written groundbreaking biographies of Stravinsky, Mussorgsky, and Debussy. Indeed, the first volume of your Stravinsky biography, A Creative Spring, won the Royal Philharmonic Society Prize for the best book published in the UK in the year 2000. I'm sorry that the COVID restrictions have prevented you from coming to Putney this evening, not least because it would have brought you back close to where I believe you grew up, in Richmond. However, let's begin by my asking you to tell us about your earliest musical memories from the time when you were living in these parts.
Thank you very much, Martin, for that greatly exaggerated introduction. Very nice of you. And it's true, we've known each other for 60 years, and I can remember very well the first occasion, though I don't suppose you can, when I had failed to get an award to King's because we were all in the same group. And then you came along and said, could I come and sing something in the Chapel of Keys? And you said, you're doing all right. And I remember that very, very well because, of course, having known that I didn't get the King's one, I was feeling a bit melancholy. Anyway, well, Richmond, yes. I was actually born in Chipping Norton, which is in Oxfordshire, but that was during the war. And my parents really lived in Richmond. We came back there when I was three. So my mother was an amateur musician. She was a reasonable pianist, and she had sung a lot. She told me, I mean, by the time I knew her, she'd messed her voice up by smoking, but she had sung in an extremely august organization called the Stock Exchange Music Society. And she'd sung in all sorts of grand operas, things like Merry England and that sort of thing. Anyway, she also knew a bit about singing. And she made us sing when we were little. I had an older sister, and we used to sing. I can remember singing little kind of children's songs. I was about four, maybe five, that sort of age. And we would be picking out little tunes on the piano as well. She was very good at getting us going early on. And well, as you know, Martin, those things are really of first importance. And in fact, we can play, I think, a song that I can very well remember that we used to sing, and it's a little number by Brahms. Brahms wrote some beautiful little children's songs. They're arrangements of existing folk tunes, or they're settings of folk poems by him. And this one is all about a naughty hen. I think we can just hear a little fragment of that song now.
Baby, melt away, oh my, oh my.
Brahms' Die Henne, performed by Rebecca Stör and Tobias Hartlieb. So, Stephen, it wasn't long before you yourself started singing in a choir.
That's right. Well, my mother, who hated everything to do with priests and church, was determined, nevertheless, that we would sing in the church choir. We were lucky. In Richmond, there was a rather good parish church choir at St. Matthias, which, if you know Richmond, it's the one with the very tall spire at the top of the hill. It's a Gilbert Scott church. And they had a decent choir, and we used to trot along to there on Friday afternoons, Friday evenings practice, and sing a couple of services on Sundays. And I think that was really the most formative thing for me. It was very fortunate that it was a relatively good choir, because it meant we had a rather good repertoire. We sang a whole range of things, and there were some decent things that one could sing oneself. We're going to hear something of the sort in a minute. But we also sang polyphonic music, which most parish church choirs don't attempt. I think it's sort of regarded as difficult. And I don't say that we actually sang it brilliantly, but we at least sang it. And of course, we did a lot of 19th century repertoire, and it introduced me to a whole strand of music and to the ability to perform it at short notice. Because when you sing in a church choir, as you know, Martin, you have to learn things quickly.
There's
not much time for practice. And this is why some parish church choirs are a bit shambolic, and I expect we were at times. But at least we were ambitious, I think.
No doubt. Yes,
I
ring
some bells with you, Martin.
Well, I was going to say that you, of course, became a good soloist with the choir.
Well, I did. Well, I sang the number we're going, which was one of the great solos of boys. For the boy's voice. I'm not sure it was written for that. I'm not quite certain what occasion Mendelssohn wrote this, but it's his famous anthem, Hear My Prayer, and it has a huge boy's soprano solo. And I was lucky enough to get a chance to sing that. And I don't suppose I sang it nearly as well as the performance we're about to hear, which actually I did nevertheless participate in, and so did you, Martin, because this is Mendelssohn's Hear My Prayer. We're going to hear the O for the Wings of a Dove section of that, the most beautiful part of it, sung by a boy who was actually in St. Margaret's Westminster Choir, which I joined after my time in Keys, which you've heard about. And it was a boy called Gunther Wasserteurer, who was, I think, an ex-member of the Vienna Boys Choir. Heaven knows how he came to be singing in St. Margaret's Westminster Choir. You probably do, Martin. But anyway,
I do, yes.
Was.
It was interesting. His parents were the caretakers at the Austrian Embassy in London. And he went to Westminster City School, where we drew the choruses for the St. Margaret's Choir. And of course, when I arrived at St. Margaret's, I inherited him. It was an absolute bonus. And he does sound like a Vienna choir boy.
Well, yes, I mean, he sang marvelously. Well, you'll hear him now in this long solo. I mean, I'm sure many of your members and people listening to this will know this piece quite well and will have heard it, and some of them may even have sung it. But here we are, the St. Margaret's Westminster Choir in all our glory, with this wonderful boy solo and the rest of us backing him up as best we can.
Thank you.
Over the Wings of a Dove, performed by Gunter Vassateurer, the St. Margaret's Westminster Choir, accompanied by Richard, now Sir Richard Armstrong, who was my assistant while continuing his studies at the London Opera Centre.
Why are you not Sir Martin Neary, if it comes to that now?
I've got a knighthood from some organisation in America, but I'm not quite sure whether it transfers to England. By the time you were singing the solo in Over the Wings of a Dove, Stephen, you were presumably at Kingston Grammar School before moving on to St. Paul's.
Yes, I probably the former, yes. I think I was at Kingston then, and I went to St. Paul's when I was 14. And so probably my voice was beginning to crack by then, I expect.
Yes. And what was it like musically at St. Paul's?
Oh, hopeless. There were eight houses there. They were called clubs, and there was a club music competition, and that was about the highest level they aspired to. And we would sing various jolly songs in this, and it was very poor at that time. In fact, there's an anecdote that has always sort of grated with me in a way that at St. Paul's. Because, of course, I got the Choral Award to Keys while I was at St. Paul's. And when I got it, the great thing was we were allowed to wear gowns at school, which was a tremendous sign of prestige and everything. So we all flaunted these horrible things. And I was summoned to the presence of the music master, who will now be long dead and enjoying, I'm sure, a happier world. And he said, well, congratulations on your award, but I'm very surprised. We haven't really heard very much from you while you've been at school. And I thought afterwards, well, thank you very much. He said, you're the first boy in the history of the school to be awarded a scholarship mainly on the strength of his music paper. And that was the first I'd ever heard of that. He never told me when I went to the school. He didn't say, come and see me at once, boy, because... and you've got to take part in this, that, and the other, or else. I was just left to take my own course. So in fact, what happened was I learnt how to do music, as it were, and learnt all the practicalities of music and certain repertoire at the church choir. That was really where I learnt the difficult things about singing. And that's why I was able to get that award at Keys, thanks to that.
Yes, because you obviously must have been well prepared for the choral trials. And I can say it really truthfully that in all the times we've made music together, I can hardly remember an occasion when you made a mistake.
Oh, well, that's because you weren't listening quite well enough.
But still. But thank you for that backhander. But thinking back to your kind of time at Cambridge, which composers did you really discover as a student?
As a student? Ah, well, lots. Lots and lots. I mean, in fact, a lot of composers who I thought I knew about already, like Beethoven. I mean, personally straightforward ones that one would think one knew something about. Bach. I mean, I remember being frightfully annoyed when I was a teenager, when people used to say, oh, Bach, the greatest composer who's ever existed and all that. And this sort of thing always irritated me, of course, partly because I didn't know much Bach, you see. So, but when I went to university and started actually listening to some of these things, like the Matthew Passion, which we'll hear a bit of later, and everything else that one could get one's hands on, I, of course, realized why those things had been said. Wagner was another. I knew very little Wagner, probably none when I went to Cambridge, but Wagner was around. In fact, in our third year, part of Goethe Demmering was actually a set work. So we were forced to look into the Ring to some extent. I remember enjoying doing that very much, but I'd already heard some Wagner that I just simply didn't know before. Britten was another composer. Bartok. You know, this is what happens at university, especially at Oxford, I think, but one would hope at every university that you meet your contemporaries who know things you didn't know. I hope I knew one or two things they didn't know, but I certainly know that there were a lot of things I learned I remember Bartok Music Strings Percussion Celesta, Janáček Sinfonietta, we're going to hear some Janáček later, and Tippett, another composer who I knew nothing about, I hadn't even heard of him when I went to Cambridge, but there were several things I learned there because there was a friend of mine who was an enthusiast. Britten, I remember discovering the Nocturne. I heard on a rather squeaky radio the first performance of the War Requiem in 1962 from Coventry Cathedral. And above all, Peter Grimes, his first proper opera, and which I knew nothing about at all. And I can't even remember why I really got interested in it, what it was that triggered it. Maybe somebody lent me a record or said, you must hear this, or I don't know. Or maybe I just thought, I better find out, I might have read something about it, and better find out about it. But anyway, I did. I bought the records, the one Britten himself conducted with Peter Pears. And I went to Covent Garden and saw Pears in the part. And I really got into it. I got to know that opera more or less note for note while I was at Cambridge. And I remember the very opening of that work struck me at once. And I said, well, what a fantastic opening that is. Peter Grimes is in court. He's very rough with his apprentices, this East Coast fisherman. And he's been to sea trying to catch a load of fish. And he's become lost at sea, basically. The wind turned against them. He tells you about it. And the apprentices is with him has died in the boat. And the inquest now taking place is about this death of this boy, William Spode. We learn much more about Peter Grimes as time goes on. But this opening is extraordinarily vivid. So let's just hear a bit of that. This is the trial scene from Peter Grimes.
Grimes, we are here to investigate the cause of death of your apprentice, William Spode, whose body you brought ashore from the boat of boy Billy on the 26th Ultimo. Do you wish to give evidence? Will you step into the box? Peter Grimes, take the oath after me. I swear by Almighty God.
I swear by Almighty God.
That the evidence I shall give.
That the evidence I shall give.
Shall be the truth.
Shall be
the whole truth and nothing but the truth.
The whole truth and nothing but the truth.
Shall record the story in your own words. Sailed your boat from the coast with the intention of putting into London. Why did you do this?
We'd caught a huge catch, too big to sell here.
And the boy died on the way.
The wind turned against us, blew us off our course. We ran out of drinking water.
How long were you at sea?
3 days.
What happened next?
He died lying there. Among the fish.
What did you do?
Threw them all overboard. Set sail for home.
You mean you threw the fish overboard? When you landed, did you call for help?
I called Ned Jean.
The apothecary here. Was there anybody else called?
Somebody brought the parson.
In the rector, Mr. Horace Adams.
All right, Mr. Adams.
Was there a certain amount of excitement?
Bob Bolstart is shouting.
There was a scene in the village street from which you were rescued by a landlady.
Yes, my aunt.
We don't call her that here. You then took to abuse the respectable lady. Answer me. You shouted abuse at a certain person.
See who?
Mrs. Sedley here.
I don't like interference.
Now tell me this, who helped you carry the boy home? The schoolmistress, the widow, Mrs. Eleanor Fogg. Mrs. Holford, as the schoolmistress, the widow. How did you come into this?
I did what I could to help.
Why should you help? This kind of fellow, little callous and false. There's something here, perhaps, in your favor. I am told you rescued the boy from drowning in the March storms.
So we were hearing Peter Pears, Ern Brannigan, David Kelly, the Royal Opera House Orchestra and Chorus, conducted by Benjamin Britten. Well now, at Cambridge, there must have been some characters you remember, I certainly do, such as Patrick Handley and Peter Trankel, who were both at Keys.
Well, yes. Well, Paddy Handley, I didn't know very much. He was only there for 1 year when I was there, and then he retired. But Peter Trankel was a big figure on the scene there, and very influential, very good example of the sort of thing that is important to one at university, because he was, you know, I come from a suburban background of perfectly normal people. And Peter was a larger than life figure, a controversial figure in Cambridge, homosexual, in some ways a slightly outrageous character, but extremely entertaining, cultivated, highly intelligent, brilliant musician. In his way, and composer of parts, wrote several successful entertainments, including Zuleika, which was on the West End. And he was the sort of person who left a mark on one's musical character and on one's character. He even left a mark on my face once, but that was quite another matter. He gave me a clout. I can't remember why. But I suspect I was being annoying. But anyway, and he introduced me to, it, for example, the music of Stravin, which was in a supervision. It was the supervision. That was all that happened. I suppose I'd taken some work for him to read, but he wasn't interested in that. And another supervision I went to, David Atherton was my predecessor. He was just having a supervision. And they'd been talking about Walsh. So when I arrived, Peter said, oh, here's a singer. We'll sing some Walsh. So, I mean, Walsh was not quite the sort of thing you'd normally put in front of a choral scholar. It's not quite the same sort of style. Anyway, he shoved, I think it was the Murica leader in front of me, and we spent the rest of my supervision and a lot extra of David Atherton's supervision singing Murica. I don't suppose David enjoyed it at all, because, you know, but absolutely wonderful. I mean, What better teaching experience could you have? I mean, it's much better than having a formal lecture on the subject. I was completely unaware of Walsh music before that. Yes. So that was Peter Trankel. I mean, and it's a very strong influence.
It would be easy, Stephen, for us to spend the whole evening reminiscing about Cambridge and the particular influences you had there, but I must move on to ask you how you became a music critic. How was it that you came to write a review for the Times when I think you were still an undergraduate?
Yeah, well, I got very gloomy in my last year, as probably most students do who don't have a very clear goal in life. And I didn't really know what I was going to do next. So I told this to my supervisor, Philip Radcliffe, and he said, oh, well, I mean, he didn't think much of my music theory. You know, I wasn't a genius at Bach chorales or Palestrina or that, but I could write good English. And he said, well, you write well. And an ex-student of his called Bill Mann had become the Times music critic. So he said, well, Bill Mann has been asking me if there's anybody, so I'll recommend you to him. And he did that. And I went and saw Bill and had lunch with him. And that was in the Easter holidays. No, which are, yes, the Easter holidays in 1963. And he said, well, you can go and do this and that. And he gave me a 3 or 4 things to do, which I did. I mean, I'm deeply embarrassed when I read them back now. It was not surprisingly. I mean, I had no experience of actually writing about other people in a public place like that, none at all. It was absolutely outrageous to give me the opportunity. But anyway, I did.
Yes, and in those days you had to meet a deadline in time for it to be published in the following morning's paper.
Always appeared the next morning. Well, the first concert I reviewed was Hungarian String Quartet. That was on a Saturday night, so one didn't have to file till the Sunday sometime. But everything else was always that night. You had to get it in by midnight. And it was quite a nerve-wracking experience at first. One eventually acquires a sort of technique. But I didn't have any technique at that time, needless to say.
But it's interesting, you didn't have much actual advice given you either by Philip or Bill Mann as to how you should write.
No, he didn't give that sort of advice. The only thing was I reviewed a concert by Rosalind Turek, who played Bach on the piano, which was a very unfashionable thing to do at that time, at least among the conoscenti. The only thing he said to me about that was, don't be too nice about her.
So. Well, it sounds if you were pretty nice about the Budapest String Quartet playing from that first concert you reviewed. Shall we hear them?
It was the Hungarian String Quartet, but we're going to hear the Budapest String Quartet playing one of the pieces that was in that concert. It was a Beethoven concert. And the main piece was the late A minor quartet, which I did know, because I'd taken trouble to get to know it. I was terrified of you know, going to a concert full of works that I didn't really know very well. And so I took a bit of trouble and studied it in the recording we're going to hear, as a matter of fact, and played by the Budapest. And we're going to hear a bit of the slow movement, which is the Heiliger Dankgesang, the thanksgiving for someone who's recovered from illness. In the Lydian mode, that's the C major mode with an F sharp. That's the curious colouring of this particular piece, but it's the most extraordinary, wonderful piece of music, one of the slowest pieces. This ability to write music as slow as this, one of the great geniuses of Beethoven. Nobody had done it before, I don't think, or since perhaps.
Thank you.
part of the slow movement of Opus 132, performed by the Budapest String Quartet. So, Stephen, you'd got a taste for some critic writing, but what were you going to do when you came down from Cambridge? What did you think?
Well, I was going to go. I mean, I was going to go ahead with writing, which was the only thing I could do. Well, I could sing, you see, but I didn't fancy becoming a singer. I mean, I knew I wouldn't be good enough to do that, and so I wrote basically. But I joined various choirs. I sang for a time in St. James Piccadilly Choir under an elderly gent called Bruce Hilton Stewart. And it was actually at a party given by Bruce Hilton Stewart with some very, very disgusting Spanish Burgundy at Christmas 1963 that I agreed to take John Walker, who was a former choral scholar of King's Cambridge, to King's Cross Station to get him to go home. This was a very unwise decision because I woke up on the edge of the square opposite the Victoria and Albert Museum with a policeman standing over me and a car, a wreck in the middle of the road, and poor Johnny Walker lying flat on the back with blood pouring out of his head. And that was not a very auspicious beginning to my career as a London choir singer. But in any case, I sang that choir for a while. And then Martin, you...
I lured you.
Recruited me, I think, and a number of other fellow ex-Keys choral scholars to sing at St. Margaret's Westminster.
Yes.
That was a very nice thing to be asked to do.
It was our good fortune.
Yeah.
And you retain a love of music of the golden age, don't you? And that era of English church music.
Yes. Yes. I mean, we sang, of course, a lot more stuff, and I think we sang it a lot better. I mean, for one thing, you had some incredibly distinguished people in that choir, on and off. For instance, James Bowman turned up occasionally and sang, and Grayson Burgess,
yes.
Donald Burgess sang. And I met him there, and it was very nice to meet these guys. They were very brilliant. And
yes.
John Nixon, Lee Nixon, yes. As he became, and was about 16 or 17, threw his weight around a bit, but he was a wonderful singer, even at that age.
Yes.
And so on. So there were some very good people that one met, and that was also influential. In fact, it influenced me to stop eventually because I realized I couldn't match them.
You kept going by writing and also working a bit for the BBC, didn't you?
Yeah, I did. Life was so much easier in those days, Martin. I mean, now you have to pass so many tests and fill in so many forms to get anywhere. I was, again, at the Wigmore Hall, and I was sitting next to a chap who was just reading the programme. And then I said something to him like, you know, nice day or something like that. And he turned to me and he said, well, who are you anyway? So I said, well, I said who I was, and I was reviewing for the Times. He said, well, I'm John Late, he said, and I am a BBC producer and I produce Record Review. And you must come and appear on Record Review. He didn't have any clue whether I had a presentable voice or anything at all. He knew nothing about me except that we'd been sitting together in Wigmore Hall. So I did, and he dragged me along to the BBC, and I did a Record Review, and I did another Record Review, and I did a comparison of all the versions of Bruckner's Fourth Symphony, of which I think there were five at the time. There are probably 100 now, but. Extraordinary, and it was live at that time too. Those broadcasts were live, not anymore. Well, they are on and off, bits of them are now, but that building a library slot was live then and came to be recorded later because of various accidents that took place.
Well, you obviously coped with all these things. Tell us about the piece you've chosen by Josquin.
Well, Zosko is a discovery of a later time, but it represents the sort of thing that, you know, this was much too difficult music for us to sing in St. Matthias in Richmond, but it was the kind of thing we might well have been singing at St. Margaret's. I don't think we did actually sing this piece, which is Josquin's Ave Maria. But really, I only discovered about Josquin later at Cardiff University, where I became a lecturer later on. But I found this music absolutely wonderful, and we did sing it. I sang it somewhere other in a family group, and we sort of struggled through it and so forth. And I just think the Josquin is one of the greatest composers of the sort of music that you might hear in sung by a church choir. And this is a wonderful, actually one of his simplest pieces, although it's not all that simple.
Ave Maria by Josquin, performed by the Chapelle Royale, directed by Philippe Herwegger. Now we're going to move to a different idiom, a piano work by Robert Schumann, which I will allow you in due course to pronounce, Stephen.
Well, it's called the Davidsbühne Tänze, which means Dances of the League of David, which was something that Schumann invented because he had it in for what he called the Philistines, who were the people who didn't like the sort of music he liked and weren't very progressive in his opinion. And this was in the 1830s. And so he created an imaginary league of the people who he thought would be on his side in this battle against the Goliaths of the Philistines and so on. And they included people like Chopin, who didn't know that he was being included, and Paganini, who didn't know he was being included, and various other figures in German music of the day, who in some cases did know. And then he wrote a piece called Carnival for piano, which is kind of suite of short pieces, all based on a collections of notes that come from the town of the girl that he was engaged to at the time. And then this piece, the David's Wintertänzer, is another set, a similar suite. And he wrote these pieces, these very short, that's a long work, David's Wintertänzer, lasts half an hour, piano solo, but it's a lot of short movements that whiz along. And they remind me of something that I always find wonderful about Schumann, that he improvised. He sat at the piano and improvised. It's something I used to do as a child, to my parents' horror. They hated it, probably rightly. But Schumann would sit for hours on end improvising. And I like to think that these works, consisting of these short pieces linked together, were a kind of a crystallization of his improvisations, this brilliant imagination of different, this collection of different ideas. And this particular movement is one, it's got two different parts to it, both equally wonderful. Tremendous vitality and vigor, characteristic of Schumann in his 20s. And so this is, I mean, they don't have titles, these sections. This is number 13 of the David's Wintertänzer.
Thank you.
Number 13 of Schumann's Davidbündel Tänzer, performed by Mari Pariah. And I think you heard several performances of that piece at the Wigmore Hall, Stephen.
Yes, that sort of thing. Now, Schumann was a great favourite of actually a lot of pianists who, to tell the truth, couldn't play it very well. It's not easy, that stuff. It's my great sadness that I can't play most of it, though I have a bash. And it's good stuff to bash through, actually, I must say, when there's nobody listening. Carnival we heard quite a lot of, and the symphonic studies, the work I remember hearing performed really terribly by a young girl who really couldn't handle it. And actually, I was at that concert with Bill Mann, who was actually reviewing it. I was probably reviewing someone else. And he said his review started, "Anyone who's ever found themselves in charge of a large lorry with the brakes having failed going down a 1-in-3 hill will have some idea of the experience of this young lady," I won't name her, in playing Schumann's symphonic studies. So there was a good and bad experiences for Schumannites in the Wigmore Hall, but a lot of Schumann got played. And it's wonderful, wonderful, that piano music of Schumann.
Fascinating. But now we go back to somewhere, someone safer, and a performance which we can have confidence in, from the Matthew Passion. Tell us about that.
Yes. Well, there's not much to say about it, really. I mean, I mentioned Bach earlier. I came rather late to realizing just how wonderful Bach was. And I remember the first time I heard the Matthew Passion played by an early music group. It was Harnoncourt, probably in the end of the 60s or early 70s. And I have a feeling, did his wife play the violin? I think she did. And anyway, when this aria we're going to hear, Erbarmadich, struck up, I just disintegrated. It was one of the most beautiful moments, I think, in any music. And it comes in the story when Peter he's just denied Christ three times. And that moment, he goes outside and weeps bitterly. If you remember, "Weinet bitterlich" is what the evangelist sings. And then there's a pause, and then the violin strikes up with the music we're going to hear now. And it just encapsulates everything one feels about one's inadequacy, I think. It's just something that hits a horrible nail right on the head in the most wonderful, gentle, unforgettable way.
Thank you.
Ebarmadig, from the Matthew Passion, performed by Michael Chance, the English baroque soloist, and John Elliott Gardiner. I was going to ask you, Stephen, what the impact was you felt of the period instrumental implosion, really. I remember you coming, I think, to a Winchester performance of the Matthew Passion in the early 80s. I mean, it made such a difference to us as performers. What was the effect on you as a listener?
Yes, well, that was a lot later. The first impact was David Munro, who you will have known at Cambridge as well.
Yes.
He was a contemporary of ours, and he was at Pembroke. But he was really an initiator of the performance of medieval music in what was deemed to be an authentic way, although I don't think it was possible really to establish whether it was authentic or not. But it was extremely vibrant and lively. He founded a thing called the Early Music Consort, and David himself played every conceivable medieval wind instrument with extreme virtuosity. And that was my introduction to that kind of thing. His colleague Chris Hogwood was also a contemporary of ours. He played keyboards and one or two other things. And they were an amazing group, and their concerts were extremely exciting. I don't think that they were researched in quite the same way that would now be regarded as necessary. I doubt if it was even possible to research that music of that period with the degree of precision that it perhaps is for later periods. Anyway, that was the first thing. And then, of course, it spread very rapidly in the 60s, to the Baroque period and the early classical period. And then one had Harmoncore, and Chris Hogwood himself was doing that kind of thing. And it gradually, initially, as you probably remember too, the standards of performance was a bit variable, and
yes,
intonation of stringed instruments, com si, com sa. But it got better and better, and then the time came when they were performing as brilliantly as anybody else. And that's what happens now, I'm happy to say. And it's a very exciting thing. I don't think it's anything one needs to be doctrinaire about, but it introduced standards of performance, standards of understanding of what went into the music in the first place and how it was done, which helped, I think, but it didn't necessarily dictate, or shouldn't dictate, but it just gave you a broader understanding and a feeling for the music. And I think we've all benefited from that, including modern performance, which doesn't use early music instruments. I think it's all improved as a result of that.
Oh, it's had an impact on them, yes, definitely. Well, now, let's think more about the role of the music critic. Do you remember an article by the former Guardian music critic, Edward Greenfield, who wrote that he would much prefer it if, instead of critic, we could find a crisp word meaning one who appreciates? He also asked the question, how can the experience of listening be described adequately? And I wondered if you've ever declined to review a concert because you knew you wouldn't like to go to it.
No, well, one certainly didn't refuse to go to anything. One was just a hack, you know. I was writing for any paper that would print my stuff, and I was in no position to refuse to go. That would be regarded as very high and mighty, and I'd have lost work. I probably wouldn't, you know, next time somebody thought of asking me, they'd say, oh, well, he'll probably turn it down. One couldn't afford to do that sort of thing. But, yes, one got sent to some pretty gloomy things initially because one wasn't a person of any importance. One was just filling gaps. One was a stringer, a hack. Later, one got better things. And when I started writing for The Observer in 1966, I was assistant to Peter Hayworth, who wasn't in terribly good health. So he quite liked not doing all sorts of things. And so I then started getting sent to really much more fun things, much more sort of highbrow opera and even lowbrow opera and good concerts at the Festival Hall and even abroad. I went to Bayreuth and for the paper and Metz Festival and all sorts of rather exciting things like that. And those were the days. They paid one's fare and one's hotel. The Edinburgh Festival one would be in for a week or 2 weeks. Well, it was great fun, wonderful. And all the food was paid for, you know. It was great being a hack in those days.
Yes, it sounds wonderful, but I'm sure one of the things you'd have enjoyed being sent to was Boris Godunov.
Ah, yes. Well, that's true. The first time I reviewed that was actually Sussex University put on the original version of Boris, and it was a university performance, so it wasn't all that brilliant, and that was the first time I heard that music live, I think. But subsequently, I heard it many, many times, and it's one of my very favorite works. And since I've then wrote a book about Mussorgsky, or about the whole circle that he belonged to, the Kuchka, as they're called, the little heap, the mighty little heap, the Moguchaya Kuchka. So I got to know more Mussorgsky, including a lot of stuff that he never finished. He was a terror for not finishing stuff, like Kovanshchina. I won't get you to say that one, Martin. But
thank you.
I get that. But that unfinished opera, I've come to love. But Boris is the great work. It's one of the great operas of the 19th century. And it comes out of a whole different approach to operatic writing. Because Mussorgsky, well, for a start, he belonged to a group that wanted to produce some music that was particularly Russian. They hated the Germans. They hated everything to do with academic study and conservatoires and all that, loathed it. Partly because they didn't have one in St. Petersburg or had only just got one, and they hadn't been to it. So they sort of chose to despise all that side of life. And they set about doing things in a different kind of way. And they used folk song to some extent, or folk idioms. And Mussorgsky even went out into the highways and hedgerows and started writing down the way the peasants spoke. And then he tried to write music which copied the actual prosody of Russian speech. And his first attempt at that was an opera called The Marriage, based on a play by Gogol, which he set word for word. And he got rather bored with that and started writing Boris, which is based on a play by Pushkin. And here he relaxed a little bit, but he wrote quite a lot in the sort of the way Russians speak, but he elevated it into music. And the result is a wonderfully original and very vivid approach to psychology of the central character, Boris Godunov himself. And the chorus, the people of Russia have this, he's brilliant at portraying them. And we're going to hear a scene from, actually, which very annoyingly, Mussorgsky, when he revised the work, he cut the scene out, but can't be helped. Anyway, we can still listen to it, I'm glad to say. It's set in St. Basil's Square in Moscow. And Boris Godunov, who in this play is deemed to have been guilty of murdering the Tsarevich, the young heir to the throne of Russia, so that he himself could seize power, is riddled with guilt. And meanwhile, a pretender has arisen and is leading a Polish army against Boris. And Boris is in a terrible state. And in this scene, we hear the chorus a little bit, discussing among themselves in a typical Mussorgskyan style, very vivid. And then we hear this character who tends to be translated as a simpleton or idiot, which is what the Russians call yurodivy, which is a kind of holy fool with a hotline to heaven who goes around with a begging bowl and is regarded with great reverence by the Russian people, so that if the Yurodivy comes to your door, you give him food. You don't make fun of him. And he can say what he likes. He's rather like the fool in King Lear. He can say what he likes, and he does. And Boris, in this scene, has been at Mass in the St. Basil's Cathedral, and he comes out, and the Yurodivy confronts him And because I should say that the little boys in the square, in the crowd, have pinched his, he had one coin, a kopeck, and the boys have pinched this kopeck. So the orderly appeals to Boris, and he says, "Boris, Boris, the boys have stolen my kopeck. Why don't you murder them the way you murdered the Tsarevich?" Well, of course, nobody can say that sort of thing. And they try and arrest him, but Boris says, "No, no, leave him. He's Yorodovy. Yorodovy, pray for me." And the Yorodovy says, "No, Boris, I'm not allowed to pray for you. The Virgin Mary won't allow it." It's the most wonderful confrontation. It's unforgettable music.
Oh,
Part of Boris Godunov, performed by Ruggiero Raimondi, Nikolai Gedda, the National Symphony Orchestra of Washington, conducted by Mstislav Rostropovich. And I think, Stephen, we're going to have another link now. Our next link is to another opera, Janáček, which you consider particularly strong.
Yes. Janáček was certainly a late discovery of mine, except for the Sinfonietta, which was one of my Cambridge discoveries, because I had a friend who loved Janáček. So that, but for some reason, I don't remember ever hearing any other Janáček at that time. And of course, his operas were not so accessible then. They had begun to be performed under Charles Mackerras at Sadler's Wells. And he did, I think, The Cunning Little Vixen, perhaps Kataka Bonova. And I know the Macropolis case they did because I saw that. And I loved this music. It was something uniquely personal and very moving. Again, very vivid, very real characterizations, very deep psychology and all that. And the bit that I've always found most moving in Janáček is the ending of Yennefer. Now, Yennefer is a relatively early, he was a very late developer, Janáček. And Yennefer, which is the first opera of his that we're likely normally to hear nowadays, was written when he was 50. And it wasn't even performed. He was based in Brno, a Czech composer. And it wasn't performed until it was put on in Prague 12 years later in 1916. And then his other operas are later. But this work, it's so real. It avoids all the kind of artificialities of opera. If you think of a contemporary work like La Bohème, for example, just a little bit earlier, and it's a wonderful work. I love La Bohème. But if you think about the characterization and what actually goes on in that work, it's pretty artificial. It's very stagey. And Mimi's death from tuberculosis at the end of it is all a bit kind of hammed up, etc. To wonderful music, so who minds? But in Janáček, it doesn't happen that way. And what happens in this work, Yennefer, is that she's in love with one of two half-brothers, and the other half-brother is in love with her. And they have a very kind of stormy relationship, she and the half-brother she isn't in love with, the one she who is in love with her. He even slashes her face with a knife at one point. But she has a baby by the other half-brother who then deserts her. And, it goes through a number of tawdry episodes, including her stepmother, burying the baby under the ice. Now, all sorts of horrible things happen. But at the end of it all, in the last act, they're at a wedding, somebody else's wedding, and the baby's body is discovered under the ice. And the child comes in saying this horrible thing has happened. And the stepmother admits to her crime. And everybody goes away and abandons Yennefer at this point. But Lhotse, the brother who she didn't love, but who has stayed true to her, even though he slashed her face, stays. And at this moment, this final duet between them, one of the most moving moments in any opera, she says to him, "Now go." Obviously, I don't know Czech, but I think that means go away now, you two. And he says, "No, I'm not going to go. I stay. I still love you." And and it sort of ends like that. They come together in this way, which you know will survive. There's nothing artificial or shallow about it. So it's very brief, And oddly enough, the orchestral theme, that theme, which we hear very early on, is very similar to the theme that ends La Bohème, oddly enough. And so I've always found that rather symbolic, actually, that fact. Anyway, let's hear this very final scene, the last 3 minutes or so of Yennefer.
That was the final duet from Janáček's Yennefer, performed by Elizabeth Sörström, Wiesla Ockmann with the Vienna Philharmonic Orchestra, conducted by Charles Mackerras. Stephen, let's now move on to contemporary music. You must have heard an enormous number of premieres, yes. Some which you remember with pleasure and some not quite so much.
Yes, rather more of the latter, I think. But
you've opted to choose a piece by the avant-garde composer Harrison Birtwistle. What engages you about his music?
Well, that's the $100 question. I don't know is the answer. There is something about Harry's music that I find irresistible, especially his concert music. I find the operas go on too long for me, but the music itself, I love, on the scale of his concert works. And I should just say about modern music generally, since you mentioned it in that way, that this is something that one got sent to a lot, you see, in the 60s and 70s. I was talking earlier about being sent to gloomy events, you know, and there were all these concerts put on by the SPNM, the Society for the Promotion of New Music, and the Norton concerts, and one or two other organized Park Lane group. I remember, of course, sometimes they made discoveries and did very good things, but of course there was an awful lot of dross. And the problem with modern music, I came to think, was that it was composed, if you were a young composer of my generation in the 60s, writing music, obviously you were writing new music, and there were certain stylistic requirements you had to meet. You had to be writing music that was either serial or dissonant or weird in a variety of ways. If you didn't do that, you just weren't taken seriously. And I've since come to realize that a lot of these composers would have been, as it were, the San Martinis of the 18th century. They would have been writing, you know, concerto grossi or violin concertos or little sinfonias or I don't know what else, that kind of thing for some court or some or church music. They would have had posts, and although they wouldn't be writing music that we'd be interested in now, that wouldn't matter. That wouldn't be the point. They would be serving a purpose then, and of course it was out of that kind of music, that kind of society, that the great composers like Mozart and Haydn emerged, that they were the sort of top of that stack, that pyramid. But with modern music, it didn't work that way, because a lot of these composers were writing music that nobody really wanted or needed, and they would get one performance and that would be that. Nobody went to hear it except people who had to, and it was a very sad scene. Stravinsky apparently said at one concert, he went to a new music concert, and at the end of it he said, "Yes, but who needs it? Who needs it?" And he was right, in a way. Now, Birtwistle is one of the sort of top echelon composers who doesn't strike me in that way. I think that he's always had to write in the way he writes, and he's invented his own style, which is a curious mixture of the kind of modernism that was regarded as de rigueur in the 1960s and 70s, and something very old-fashioned and folksy that's gone slightly haywire. And a lot of his early pieces, like a piece called Down by the Greenwood Side, I remember seeing, was a kind of amalgam of this very noisy modernism and something very antique and ancient and very English and very to do with the greenwood and oak trees and, you know, that side of English rural life. And I think he had a kind of understanding of all that, even though he puts it in musical terms that do not conform with conventional standards of beauty. That's clear. And I've never, you know, you asked me what it is about Birtwistle that appeals to me, and I find it very hard to say. I have to say to people, because people do are apt to ask one this question, because they can't see why one should like it, and I say I don't know either. I think it's horrible, really.
Well, may we hear something of him? Is it from?
Yeah,
the secret?
Let me just say about this piece, Secret Theatre, which we're going to hear. It starts with a flute solo, and then we hear a certain amount of accompaniment chords and things against this. And it's the movement of this music and the melody. And what Birtwistle has, he has a kind of what would have been called a concertino in the 18th century. That's a sort of cantus or a small group of solo instruments. And he has also a kind of ripieno, as it were, which is the other lot. And the solo instruments play always its melody all the time, these long melodic lines. they're not melodies you and I are going to sing, but they're nevertheless recognizably that. And there's something in the way this music moves that I find very, very appealing. It's an artificial theater. Secret Theater is a poem by Robert Graves. And he's imitating something, unpredictable theatrical events at night when we go to bed. We don't know what's going to happen to us in dreams and so forth. And it's prompted by that, I think.
That was the opening of Secret Theatre by Harrison Birtwistle, performed by the Ensemble Intercontemporain, conducted by Pierre Boulez. We're going to move now to another composer on your list for whom you've written a biography, Claude Debussy. I love the subtitle, A Painter in Sound. Do give us some examples of what you find in this respect?
Well, I think it comes from an orchestral piece he wrote in the 1890s called Nocturnes. And the first piece is called Nuages, Clouds. And I think it's possible that this piece was inspired by Whistler's Nocturnes. Remember those paintings of Whistler, Nocturnes in Blue and Gold, and that kind of title that he had. And I think Debussy he's in a way painting the sky, and the sky the clouds move, but they don't move. You know what the skies are like. We all know what the sky is like. It moves, and yet it doesn't seem to change very much. And in that way, Debussy seemed to me to be echoing the Impressionist painters. I don't think that was a conscious process. I think it was just something, his way of responding. He was in rebellion against the conservatoire, rather like the Russians, who actually influenced him. And he thought that there was far too much talked about the logic of music and the kind of this relentless forward pressure. He loved Wagner, but I think he didn't like the huge scale of Wagner. He loved the sounds, and he would pick out particular sounds, and then he would write about them as if you were peering into the sound. You know what I mean? You weren't worrying about where the sound was going. You were just investigating this sonority, this sound. And he then turned to writing piano music, and you get this particularly in his piano music. The piece we're going to hear is called Cloche à travers les feuilles, which means bells through the leaves, which is a sort of mixture, what came to be called synesthesia, a mixture of different senses, because you bells, things you hear, leaves are things you see, and you can imagine the flicker of the leaves and the sound of bells coming through that. And it's this single image that Debussy has concentrated on. And the result is a sort of movement of textures, rather like the leaves moving, or the change of light and shade and the sounds coming through. Nothing much changes except gradually and very slightly. But there's something wonderful about this way of writing for the piano, completely unlike anything that anybody had written before, I think. It comes from the second book of Images, or Images for piano.
That was Cloche à travers les feuilles by Debussy, performed by Noriko Ogawa. You love this music, Stephen, it prompts me to ask if you've ever desired to be a performer, professional performer yourself.
Any desire to be one?
Yes.
No, well, no, except in, I enjoyed singing in professionally in the sorts of choirs that you have run. I always enjoyed that. Didn't pay very well, I may say. You might care to note that, Martin, but but it was a great fun, great pleasure singing alongside other people who were really good at it and encountering music one didn't know before, and being part of that, yes. But I never had the ability, for instance, I mean, I play the piano, but no one wants to sit and listen to me play the piano. And the minute anybody does sit and listen, I become even worse as a player.
You're too self-critical. I'm going to stop you there. I'm going to stop you there and be the choirmaster telling you to listen to the next and final question. We come to your final choice, The Rake's Progress by Igor Stravinsky, about whom I suspect you know as much as anyone in the world. What would you say was the most surprising thing, if you could repeat it, you learnt about Stravinsky when you were doing your research for the books?
Well, there were a great many surprises in that. I think that perhaps the most surprising thing was what a timid youth he was. Because he was very small, and he was one of four brothers, and he wasn't regarded as in any particular way talented. And I think he didn't feel superior. He didn't even know, he didn't have a very strong vocation as a child or as a young boy. His father was a singer at the Mariinsky Opera, so he was in touch with music a lot. He learned to play the piano and met a lot of the great musicians of the day, like Rimsky-Korsakov and a great many others of that era, because his father was singing in their operas. And so from that point of view, he was in contact with music as a child, but he was not this very forward, confident person that he seems in later life. And that had always emerged from biographies of Stravinsky, because the biographies were written by people who on the whole couldn't read Russian. And so they were concentrating on the time when he came to Europe in 1910 and was writing his letters in French and in German, and later still in English. And the Russian side of him, his letters to his parents, his correspondence with other Russians, which went on all his life, reveal a very different side to his character, which to some extent was insecure. And he was very insecure as a child, and sort of did what his parents told him and looked after himself because they ordered him to. And then later, he was insecure because he was an exile, and doubly exiled. He was exiled to Switzerland, then France, then ended up in America. And he just felt a lot of the time very unsure of his status as an artist eventually, but of his security as a person and financially later on. So I think that was the thing that surprised me most, especially in his younger days, where one's talking about 19th century Russia. It's almost like Tolstoy, you know, the times, and very different from anything later on.
Why have you chosen this particular movement, Stephen?
Well, it's difficult to, there's so much of Stravinsky's music that I love and admire. And I suppose the Rake's Progress is a piece that I've come to like more over the years. And it's a much more complicated piece. And it's often talked about as if it were just another piece of neoclassicism, and probably, you know, we're a bit weary of neoclassicism and let's move on to something else. But actually, the Rake's Progress is a much more complicated piece than that, and it contains quite a lot of things. I wrote a book about Stravinsky's music once, which, and that was what introduced me to elements of this music that I just hadn't noticed. It's one of the good things about writing about things is you actually get to know about them. Should be the other way around, I know, but I've always found that I find out things that I didn't know. And that was true of this work, that it's made up of a lot of rather ritualized things, little kind of verses and refrains, and it has a very interesting structure as a work. I know that a lot of it sounds like sort of modernized Mozart, but the design behind it and the different elements or ingredients that go into it are really fascinating. And this particular excerpt, Tom Rakewell, who's the anti-hero of this work, he's been left a lot of money by an uncle. Well, he hasn't really, but this is what the devil in the form of Nick Shadow comes to his house and tells him that he has, in order to corrupt his soul. So Nick Shadow carts Tom Rakewell off to London in order to set him up in more ways than one, set him up, as it were, in a grand house because on his uncle's money, but also to set him up for landing him in hell, double quick. And his first way of setting him up in the latter way is to take him to a brothel. And this, the first scene in London, actually, after the opening scene, which is in the country, is set in this brothel. And we have all sorts of insalubrious types, roaring boys and whores, and I don't know what else. And they sing some very beautiful music. And at the end of the scene, when Tom has gone through a slightly bad patch of remembering the girl that he's supposed to be marrying back home and regretting that he's so far away, but they wave all that away, and they say, oh, nonsense, and they form lines and sing this wonderful chorus as he and the madame of the brothel sort of process down the middle. And this is a kind of initiation ceremony for all sorts of horrors, which I'm glad to say were not actually shown in the opera, but we can imagine them if we want to. And anyway, this is beautiful music sung by insalubrious people, which has always been a rather fascinating combination, I think.
Part of the brothel scene in Act 1, Scene 2 from Stravinsky's The Rake's Progress, performed by the LSO Monteverdi Choir and John Elliott Gardner. Stephen, what a truly fascinating evening you've given us. You've shared not only your enthusiasms, but also your exceptional analytical powers and your open-mindedness, as well as your sense of humour. I just wish we could have had more, perhaps some personal, but then we can put that right when in due course we'll hope to invite you back in person. Thank you, Stephen.
Well, thank you very much for having me. It's been a great pleasure. And it's very nice of you to say all those nice things. And I'm glad it came across like that. And I'd love to come again. It would be lovely to meet your members. And after all, that's what it's all about. So that will be great. And I accept the invitation in advance, just in case you forget.
Thank you again.